Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. Today continue with the series of videos I'm preparing regarding the different ML, AI, generative AI services that have the different cloud providers like Google, Amazon or Azure. I will continue with the offering of the Google, Vertex AI, and specifically in the matter of the, well, how to work with generative solutions in terms of language, querying, creating chatbots, these kind of things. No? Let's go to that, and then I will get you some insight about that. Okay. Well, assuming that you already have access to Google Cloud, you had already your account in place, you can access and you already activate all the Vertex AI APIs. If not, you can take a look to the channel. There is videos OCR, for example, where in the Cloud Vision series where you can see how to set up the account. In any case, I will give you again some information about how to set up which libraries you specifically need to work with the Vertex AI, and also with the new models, with Gemini, and with everything that you need to work with this service in Google Cloud. But in this video, I'm assuming that you already have it, and I know we'll go through this again and just go to the point in that matter. Okay, so if you go to the AI solutions, AI section in Google Cloud. Let's imagine that you already are there. You remember that you had here multiple services. You had the A platform, natural language, recommendation engines, speech, table, etc. We focus in Vertex AI, which is more focused in generative AI, and is probably the service where Google is putting more focus right now. Okay, so we are here in the dashboard, and today you see the channel. If you are following the channel, we prepare a video introducing the service and also introducing the new model that Google released a couple of months ago, Gemini. But today we will speak about this section, specifically this section is language, and then here this section specifically is prepared for work with LLMs in tasks like summarization, like COT, classification, text classification, like sentimental analysis, extraction, or extraction, which means extract from a text something that is like an abstract summary of the text. Well, you can see here that you had multiple examples about how to do this. As I mentioned in videos before, there is everything very well documented. You just need to go through and then try to find something that is similar to what you pretend to do, and I'm practically sure that you will have an example that covers your need. No, but this is not what we are talking about. This, well, we are going to see what is available in this section in Vertex AI. And for those that are familiar already with the OpenAI dashboard, and also with the Microsoft OpenAI dashboard, you will find this that is pretty similar. Well, you have in the dashboard, you have obviously the part of generator that is questioning or making queries to a LLM using prompts. You can use different techniques, prompt engineering. By the way, I had also some videos about prompt engineering in the repository I will provide. You know where it is. It's in every video I make, there is a link to the repository. And also, you had access from this part, this section, to code prompt, which, well, for those again that are familiar with OpenAI, you will know that they had a Well, a role and an assistant to generate code in different languages. You also had, similarly, than OpenAI, and sorry to be so repetitive, but you had here the same that ChatGPT and also were kind of the human interaction with the machine, that where you can ask, okay, give me a code for this, for that, and refine your queries in a conversation with a bot. Okay? What is interesting here in Vertex AI? First of all, well, you can save your prompts for further refinement in the in next iterations. You can try several times and well, follow the chain of decisions that you will make. I will show you how to do it as well. And this that for now, I think that the Microsoft OpenAI Studio offers a similar thing, but when I prepare the video with Microsoft, I will take a look and compare with this service. For now, and sorry if I'm wrong, this is the first time I see it in any cloud provider, and it's the ability to fine tune your models. No, this is really interesting. Many advantages and slightly small disadvantage. I will tell you what I think in a few seconds. So you have the possibility to create a tune model, supervised tuning. This is something that we already cover as well in the channel, how to fine tune a model for a specific task like tag summarization, text summarization, or the chain of through. And then I make some videos, and then you have it available on the channel and as well in the repository. This I didn't still cover reinforcement learning from human feedback. This is another fine-tuning approach where you try to in few words eliminate from the model kind of the bias in terms of the gender, in terms of the offensive language, etc., etc. This I will make. I'm preparing, to be honest, some videos about this topic, which is really interesting, and especially in reinforcement learning. And then reinforcement learning for human feedback is a very huge topic itself. But well, the good thing and what I want to tell you with that is that you can do this with a few clicks. No, with essentially is fine. Because this, believe me, takes a lot of preparation, even research in what you want to do, how you want to approach it. And here with fine-tuning, you saw my videos doing LoRa, QLoRa, or any fine-tuning, prompt-tuning, fine-tuning with prompt fine-tuning. It's taking a lot of time preparing everything, preparing your data set, creating well all the infrastructure and logistics, no, to do this kind of things. And here, well, with few clicks you can do it. No, this is advantages. Obviously, what are the disadvantages? That you can only do it with their models. Well, it's fine for people who is working in Vertex AI, it's completely fine. But if you are like me and you had your or the company for where you are working for had their own requirements, and you, for example, like in my case, you had to prepare models that had to run on premises and you cannot use services like this, well, this is this is not an advantage at all. But for those cases that you have your infrastructure running in Google Cloud, this is, well, in my opinion, like AutoML. If you know what is this, it's just preparing a ML or deep learning model with a few clicks. The cloud providers provide you everything, no? In well, a kind of model that is very good for experimentation. This is also very good for experimentation. But the question, the same that with AutoML, is, well, what is the quality of this? At the end of the day, this is a black box, and don't forget that you don't know what's going on under the hood. And then if you want to have control of what is going on, well, probably it's better to do it yourself. But in any case, for quick fast prototyping and these kind of things, I think is really valuable tool, and you can explore it, especially if you are working with Google Cloud. And then for other case use case scenarios, like in my case where I'm working off on premise, because well, when you work, for example, for government, for the defense sector, it's very difficult that you have access to this kind of things. But it's not the matter of this video. The matter of the video show you how to do, how to work with LLMs, specializing language, in Vertex AI. I find it again very interesting, and then with a few clicks you can have, you can fine tune your model, you can later on decide your data set, you can do reinforcement learning for human feedback, which is really important as well, especially today with all these topics of the LGTB and bias in models, etc. For people who is working like me in this world, you know very well what I'm talking about, and then this is very important. And then, well, it's good to have this in a few clicks, as at least for prototyping is, well, good achievement. I had to say that the is a very good feature, no? Okay, so now let's go to here. I will start with text prompt, with querying a LLM. Probably you remember this. If you already work with OpenAI and Microsoft OpenAI Studio, well, probably what you are seeing here probably is another look and feel, but you will find that it is pretty similar to what you see here. But you have here these notes, which is really, really helping. At least in my case, I need to take notes of everything I'm doing and to follow the chain of the steps that you will do in preparing your model, taking decisions in which direction you go. This is really valuable, and like a notepad to just write. Free form, structure form, the structure just, well, here is just you are making your, it's free, you can write whatever you please. Structure is kind of the few shot prompting. You can give some example, the expected answer, and well, you can help, as I will show you before, the LLM how to respond. No API reference, very good as well. Very, very extensive documentation with a lot of model. Access to Gemini Pro, fantastic. And well, if you are working with LLMs, what you are seeing here, I think is very pretty familiar to you. I will use London. I don't want to spend too much money. Something interesting this here is, well, for a model like Gemini, which apparently had a Windows context of 1 million tokens, so limit the answer to just 8,192. To me, it seems a little bit short, no? To be honest, but well, probably this change in the future, or maybe as well, like this 1 million tokens of the Windows context is not completely true. We'll see. So in any case, you have here the normal parameters to interact with an LLM: tokens, to output tokens, temperature, safety settings. If you saw my videos before, I was speaking about that. Very pretty interesting this. I will comment it a little bit of the text in a few seconds. And then you had max response, top k, top p. I missed some of the key values like beans, but okay, you can interact pretty easily. Probably you can set up these parameters using the SDK. We will cover it later on, or maybe not. I don't know. This is I didn't see so far on the SDK. also a little bit strange, no? This is quite limited, the interactions are parameter for an LLM. But again, well, you can use this plenty of models. We will look at Bison and also Gemini Pro. You have here Getcode, pretty interesting. To get at least a snippet of how you can query the API using different languages. Also, a note here, I always thought that Google, at least in the past, I thought that they are also working with C Sharp. Well, here I don't see it, but well, probably I'm wrong. No worries. So I will not do anything here because I did it in the notebook, and then on later on I will show you the examples. This is text querying a LLM. Again, only the LLMs. You cannot work with the public LLMs. Code prompt. Well, again here you just there is a specialized models in providing answers in how to code in different language. You can try this here, give me code in, I don't know, JavaScript to create an endpoint. Which whatever, no, accept via post an image. Instead to put it here, I will put it in London. Okay. And yeah, well, I'm not an expert in JavaScript. I tested it. You will see later on the code section that I tried some stuff with images, and the answer was satisfactory. But you can play around. For the time being, this is free, especially working with the Gemini. Up to they had the final release, so you can play around anytime you want. Okay. Interesting as well, if you see my introductory video of the Vertex AI, I show you this piece of the documentation where they explain, Google explain, what is their vision about the workflow of generative AI. And well, this part, the input is fine, it's zeros of prompting, fuse of prompting, multi-tune chap, different techniques. This is, well, conventional stuff, no? One of the interesting thing is these two boxes, no? Responsible AI and safety and citation check. Responsible AI, you can, I don't need me to read you what is right here, but it's checking if your model is answering something offensive with hate language, all these things that today are really important. And well, I think it's a really interesting feature. I didn't see it, by the way, in the other in the competitors, OpenAI, Microsoft. And the second feature that is really interesting is this citation check. I can imagine that they created because of this case in the court. I think it's a Washington Post or New York Times versus OpenAI, where they are claiming because of some copyrights or author rights that they because OpenAI is using some data set basis in news. And then it is quite interesting stuff. It's something that also if you work with YouTube, they are doing. Your videos or your content is containing something that may be liable for some copyright claims, they they at least warn you that it can be some problems with that. I find it very interesting. I will put an eye on what they are doing because, well, it's at least if they somebody tells you, well, you may have an issue using this data set because it's containing some content that is protected by a copyright. Well, to be honest, this is really interesting, eh? Because nobody wants to have the surprise after spending, I don't know, thousands of dollars or a lot of time in building a solution, and later on a company and tell you, well, guys, you are using my data set and you have to pay a fee, or you couldn't use it because it's only for research. And well, I especially last 3, 4, 5 years, I'm finding this in the market, in the industry, something that is very, everybody's very aware of, or everybody's putting a lot of efforts in not to make anything that is, how to say, against the law, because, well, apparently there is a lot of cases of violating the copyrights or violating the rights authors, etc., etc. So interesting features, again, at least from my side, in my opinion. Well, if you tell me what you think in the comments, if you think that is not really valuable, the features in Google. Okay. Now let's go to the code. I also give you some reference to some of the jobs I did or the videos I did before. I was preparing before some videos about the different techniques to do prompt engineering, and I also fine-tune a Mistral 7 billions with a data set specialized in chain of truth. Why chain of truth? Because chain of truth is one of the most difficult tasks for a LLM. In my opinion, still there is no one LLM which can answer correctly most of the question, especially if you start to make complicated questions to an LLM. And you will see here in this demo that most of them, even the Gemini, fails answering some reasoning questions where you had to link a couple of steps of reasoning to give the correct answers. In any case, take a look to what I publish. Also is available in the repo. The notebooks I published in days before, I don't remember when, doesn't matter. And also here I put you a link of this interesting. I recommend you to read this because, yeah, you need to somehow, you are going to work with this kind of technology, you need to understand well, what are the limitations, what are the what is possible to do. And again, I find it really interesting, this stuff, no, that they are doing. I didn't see it in OpenAI. Yeah, I see it on the contract, no? When you sign the contract to work with OpenAI, they advise you to do the, but this active checking, I didn't see it. If somebody saw it before, please correct me on the chat. Okay, let's move to the. And I also grant you here, as I am assuming that you have access already to Vertex AI and Google Cloud, I just grant you here the way to install the library. You just need this library to access Vertex AI, and also you need the CLI, the command line interface for Google Cloud. And once you have it installed, you just need to execute this command to log in into Google Cloud using the profile that you use to set up your account in Google Cloud. For the text generation models, you just need this line, these two lines. But as we are going to use as well in this demo Gemini, we need these two other lines that, as you can see here, the model is still in preview. But well, just for the languages section, you only need that. So again, we just need this class for working with the text models, and the other one is just specifically for Gemini. We load the environments variables, and we just simply create the parameters to send to for the model. Well, usual the same that you can set up using the interface. If you remember, one candidate count, maximum number of tokens. We can change that. Temperature, top P and top K. Again, I didn't try. I will do it in a next video where it's more relevant. This when we are working with images, etc. But you can the same parameters that you are using in the UI. You can send it here in just in a dictionary of parameters and send it to the model. We create an object, the text generation model from pre-trained. Well, who is working with the Hugging Face? This they know very well. This we just load the model, the Bison at 001. This I will say that is something equivalent to OpenAI 3.5 Turbo, probably at the same level. Gemini, they say that is beating 3.5 Turbo in any benchmark, and also the Ultra version is beating the GPT-4. I like everybody. If you saw the video that I published before regarding when I spoke about the Vertex AI introduction and also Gemini, I give you some links that you can analyze these links where they are comparing GPT-4 with the Gemini with the versions. Nothing is released, to be honest, in terms of how it's on Gemini. A lot of probably advertisement, a lot of discussion, a lot of comments, and nothing really tangible like a research paper with from somebody who already analyzed outside the Google, obviously, the model, and can tell you, okay, this is exactly what's it's inside or what is working under the hood. In my opinion, we will never see it. Like happened with OpenAI anyway. Okay, now I start to do some examples of chain of truth prompting. Why I started with this? Because if you watch the videos on my channel, I already prepared two videos. One is speaking about the different prompt techniques in prompt engineering. I use in that case a Mistral 7B. And also I prepare a video and an experiment of the fine-tune a Mistral 7B from Chain of Truth with a special data set that is ready to fine-tune a model, to specialize a model just in Chain of Truth. Why Chain of Truth? Because this again is an activity, is a task that no model is doing correctly, especially if you complicate the questions. Here is not only mathematical reasoning, it's also conventional reasoning when you have to follow or chain a couple of the steps in order to get a correct answer. You will see here when I put you these examples through. The first one is the one that I still didn't meet a model which answered this correctly, and I explain you well why why I don't know. Well, the why is because the models itself, they are not ready yet to answer these questions. They are very good in different tasks like summarization, like I don't know, the translation. They probably beat even humans in doing that. This is a open question yet, but in this specific task and chain of truth, the models I think they are really far away to be similar to a human. And you will see here with very, very simple questions, very simple problems or reasoning, the models are not able to answer. And you will be the surprise even with Gemini. Okay, let's go through. Here I just asking the model to make a, well, it's very simple. If you're working in accounting, you may know what is the depreciation of an asset and across the years. No, there is different methods to calculate, but one of the oldest is the clean imbalance method. Is you just get a rate. Every asset has a, you just set up a rate of depreciation per year. You may set up as well a residual value. This below this value, the asset cannot depreciate. It's always a light shadeward value. And well, you make a simple, very simple calculation. I will show you in a few seconds how it works. And then I make just a problem, no, to any model that I'm working with, and to us to calculate the depreciation of an asset across, in this case, 20 years. No, you can read the prompt. Is just I had a car 20 years ago. It cost $100,000. Annual rate of depreciation 5,000. 5%, no residual value. This means that after the period that the asset is deprecated, there is no residual value, so it can deprecate to zero. And using the declining balance method, this is again very well known. This is, I'm not an accountant, I'm not an economist, I'm an engineer in IT, but I know how it works, this method, for long, long ago. And again, I'm really surprised that it's not the LLMs cannot answer this question. But okay, you will see why I get this conclusion after seeing all the explanation. Then I just ask the calculation. Well, obviously here this is not the real value. I had in the repository where I used to post all the output that I use in my videos. And I give you the real example. This is just I get it from an online tool in Investopedia, if I don't remember wrong. And then just give you how to calculate the depreciation of a value. No, you have a value 100,000, percentage fixed percentage of depreciation every year, and period of depreciation 20 years. Here the tool is assuming that there is no residual value. Well, very simple calculation, and you will see through when looking at the schedule. No, the first year, the initial value is 100,000, the depreciation value is 5%, 5,000. End of the year, the value is $95,000. So, in beginning of the second year, the value is 95K. So, the depreciation again 5%. 4,750, and the balance 9,250. You can follow the table. It's pretty simple to make this calculation. You can do it as well with Excel. I can give you as well the link just to calculate what is the final value. And the final value after 20 years of this asset is 35,849. Okay. So. Well, I just Bison 001 Grom. I use as well the magic sentence. Let's think step by step. If you follow my videos, I show you some of them. Probably here you have it as well. It's not here in the other link I send you. There is a very interesting paper which described why the LLMs are zero reasoners. No, but I will. If you just go to the notebook, you will find the link there. It's not. I will put you, well. Exactly. I'm here, just explaining the different techniques. Yeah, here zeros of prompting, chain of through. Here, blah blah blah. No, it's here. Sorry. Ser consistent. Okay. So this paper just exactly is or is not this paper. No, sorry. This is the problems of the direct. Sometimes my internet is going very, very slow. Oops. Okay, it's not. We can find it. LLMs are zero short reaction. Okay, so this paper, you can take a look to this. It's just explaining why, well, a model LLM, if you don't give him some tips or tricks how to solve the problem, the LLM, well, most likely is going to fail answering the question. You can take a look, very interesting paper. And then, well, just they recommend introducing this sentence, something or something similar, and you this drive the model to break down the answer in different steps and kind of make a chain of through or reasoning similar to a human. Well, I do the same with Bison 001. The answer absolutely wrong. To my surprise, is I do the same with Gemini, and the answer, it was not wrong, it was completely wrong. Well, we get a value zero. They are using very, very simple depreciation formula, which nobody use because this is not real. No, if you are working with accountants and for the government, you will see that nobody use this deprecation formula. What I want to see with that is, I'm not saying anything wrong about Gemini, about the models of Google. I'm just saying that this is a tax that there is still a lot of room to improve in terms of LLMs. No, LLMs can do very good translation, can do well, very good summarization of a PPT, but this activity with well, for us to think in one of these questions and solve it very easily for a LLM, even these models which Google or OpenAI spend millions of dollars and a lot of resources to train them, are not able to do it. That's all. Take your own conclusions on think on that. And that's all. I don't want to do any bad how to say propaganda about any. It's not the purpose of this. It's just present you the outputs of this small research and how the models work. No. By the way, I try as well with OpenAI. Similar issue. It's exactly the same. No. You will see other problems at the end of this demo, and also you will see in other videos I prepare as well before the problems that in general LLMs have. No, well, I make the same these four questions. You will show this all of them connected with chain of through. Well, it's the same I did to the Mistral 7 billions. After fine tuning with the C chain of through dataset, and well, Bison 001 is asked incorrectly. Well, here is just tell me the sum up of the numbers in this list. Pretty obvious, it's only one number, 849. Here is just a question. I went to the market, I bought an apple, I gave to the neighbor, to the repairman. Then I went again, I bought five apples and I ate one, and then how many apples I had? Well, it's even making you a chain of reasoning. 10 minus 2 minus 2, 6, 6 plus 5, 11, 10, 11 minus 1, 10 apples. Perfect. No questions, no comments on that. The next question, I had a car 20 years ago, and I had at that time I was 37. How old I am? Pretty simple, 57. But this is probably a kid of 10, 12 years can answer these questions. But well, For a model, even a LLM with the, all this money that they spend, is some of them is even very very difficult and even completely wrong answers. No? So, just to give you a context that well, size or money invested that doesn't mean quality. I also, when I present the Vertex, when I present this series of video, I introduce you as well the Gemini, Gemini Pro, and I make a demonstration of the how describe a video and a picture. And in the video as well, I compare with another model, public model, free Video Llama, and I make well, I just show you the outputs. No, I recommend you to take a look and also make your own conclusions. Well. Now some techniques that also I described in the previous model, zeros of prompting. Well, this simply you just make a question and you ask for a wait for an answer. Just well, classify this text into neutral, positive, negative. It's obvious that this this is neutral. Well, because it's containing the word okay. Here we are doing fuse of prompting is that you make an example, you get an answer in the prompt, you are including an example, one or many examples of a question, and you ask later a question, and they had kind of replicate the behavior or the logic that you use to make, for example, here to create a sentence with a word. No? Here also the model is working properly. It well, I'm not a native speaker in well, come on. Here is failing. I don't know why, but usually this work without any problem. No, so. Let me check, probably I'm not using, probably we need to increase here a little bit the temperature. This is another question. So for chain of through, obviously, when you need to do a kind of reasoning mathematical task, you don't need temperature. But when you are doing other kind of questions, you need temperature. A need of creativity. Okay, now it's working. The children were far doodling around the room, laughing and having fun. If somebody is, I'm not a native speaker in English, but I know that this word is correctly used here. It is not, and somebody can comment about that. I appreciate it, and you can share this with the rest of the subscribers. Self consistency is again everybody now is researching around the reasoning to chain, no? How to make the LLMs think or make answers or get answers similar to humans, no? And then they are using different techniques. Self consistency is another one. You just get different alternatives, different possibilities, different ways of how you can or the you should answer a question. Here you look at the questions. It's just explaining step by step how to get an answer. You make several questions. By the way, in fuse of prompting, there is also research. I think I published it in videos before. If you make more than 5-6 examples, it's not worth it at all. So there is a limit where the model is, because probably the length of the prompt, but more than in between 4 to 6 examples, it's not going to make any favorable effect in the answer of the model, in any positive effect, no? So it's just consuming tokens, but you will not get better answers, no? So kind of here, probably this prompt is very long, but in any case, the model is answering correctly. You can see here, At the end, you are giving some examples with the chain of the step that you use to make the calculation and to get the answer. And at the end, well, the model is replicating very good how to make the calculation. So here we are just asking Olivia had $23, she bought 5 bagels for 3 each. How much money does she have left? No? So he made the calculation, 5 bagels, 3 each, spent $15, 23 minus 15, $8, now where is 8? Okay, nothing to say here. Generated knowledge prompting, here is something similar, again, it's just helping the model with some context, it's something similar to RAG, but in the context, it's just giving some additional knowledge to facilitate the LLM to give you an answer. And here you are just giving a question, you are doing a question, the part of the goal is trying to get a higher yes or no, you get a knowledge paragraph and you have an answer and explain why. No, I don't know why, but here in this I will run it again, but from where I took this example, I'm not a specialist in golf. If somebody is a specialist in golf and this is a correct answer, well, correct me. But in my mind, this is not the correct answer. And when I asked GPT-4 for the same, the answer was no. To my mind, this is not the objective of the goal. But again, I'm not an expert in this. So if you have the knowledge on that, please make a comment and clarify the situation. To me, this is no, because the objective is to make the less number of the stroke in the game, and the player who gained the game is not who the player which who get the higher points in total, rather than the player that get the less number of strokes. But again, I'm not an expert in golf. If you are, please help us in this. And now another topic that you will be very surprised with this. Well, you know very well as well that all these LLMs only can answer you according to the information that they were training, the information that they were used to train them. No, and then that's why if you ask for example a GPT 3.5 Turbo who was who is the president or the PM of the UK, is going to answer you Boris Johnson, which is not true today, but it was true when the model was training. No, and there is another very how to say effect interesting effect in LLMs is hallucinations. No, the model, especially if you set at a high temperature, is prone to answer you. It doesn't matter what, it had to answer you something. And you see here how many ends are in the world weather. There is nothing, but the model had to answer you something. Why cannot answer? There is nothing. No, well, and the worst is when you insist, no, you are wrong. Is what I answer in your answer. You, I make a second prompt to the model, and I ask the model, well, I made this question. That was your previous answer. Are you sure? And the answer is again is insisting in the failure. The curious, it was using Gemini. I made the same. The same was, how many ends are in weather? 2. I made the same prompt again, and yes, I'm sure. I don't want to drive you in any conclusion. Take your own conclusion. Try to play with the models. And well, if you are a data scientist or a researcher or a machine learning engineer, well, you have to drive for these kind of things. No, you need to challenge the models. You don't need to trust in what the Google say or what the OpenAI say. You just need to see with your own eyes, no? And then you can make a comment as well on the channel about this, and then if you find some other interesting how to say prompts and how to cheat the model, but well, that's I don't want to say more about this. Just make your own test, make your own how to say evaluation of this, and then you can place your comment on the channel. That's all. And the last thing I try is the code generation, also using the SDK. All this stuff, as well, you saw very well, I use the SDK, and then just ask to write some Python code just to show you how it works. It's giving you an answer. It's not really tidying, probably because the temperature is too high. Let's remove the temperature, because if you see here in the question, I'm telling the model not to use only use Python native libraries, and then here the answer is using Pillow. Pillow is not native library in Python, no, but okay. Let's make the question. Here is importing as well. Well, probably also, and probably this is my fault, I'm not a native English native speaker. Probably the question is not strictly English, no? But okay, if somebody can also create a question, a proper prompt for that, I will appreciate it, and probably the rest of the subscribers also will appreciate it. And that's all. I hope you like it. I will continue with this. I will also, I'm also challenging SageMaker, Azure Machine Learning Studio, and all the solutions in the other two cloud providers. You will see this very interesting. I like a lot of this, all this stuff, because you will find that a lot of surprises. But and it's a well, at least my approach. I don't believe ever, no, what all this propaganda that the marketing the teams of the Google or OpenAI are doing, because at the end it's something that you need to prove, and you need to know very well what are the limits and the features and how they work. When you try to provide a solution for a client, you need to know especially the limitations, no, of these models, which they are, in my opinion, far away to more of the things that they pretend to do, or they claim to do. Okay, thank you very much again, and if you like the contents, please give me a like, and subscribe the channel if you didn't do it before. See you soon.